Hi everyone. In this podcast, I am talking BDD with Gaspar Nagy, an industry expert in BDD. Let's go. Greetings everyone. Welcome to the awesome Software Testing and Quality Talks next episode. I have with me today Gaspar Nagy, who is an expert in BDD, a BDD coach and evangelist, and the author of two BDD books.
Hi, Gaspar. Welcome to the show. How are you doing today?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation and welcome, everyone. Yeah, it's a busy season, so I have a lot of things in my head, but I'm fine. Thank you.
Okay, great. Let's jump right in. So I was going through some of the BDD material and I had a few questions in mind to start with discussions. When we come up with the examples, why do we usually use only some of those examples for formulation into scenarios? What are the reasons for omitting some of the examples that we come up with?
Before I directly answer the question, let me just say a few words about how the examples come into the BDD topic, because there, I think many of the listeners probably have heard about BDD. They have already used scenarios, but they don't know what the examples are doing here. And I think explaining that is also partially will give you the answer as well. So basically, when you would like to work with in using the BDD process, then at the end you would need to produce some scenarios that you are able to automate afterwards. They're using the give and then keywords and so on. What we would like to do with BDD, that we would like to use these scenarios as a driving factor for us to be able to implement the application properly. So this means that they are not simply tests. They are not something that that you are just coming up afterwards and either they turn red or green, but we would like to use the scenarios as a kind of inspiration factor or something which is telling us where to do or where to go and what kind of steps do we want to make for that. So that's a very important element of that. However, to be able to create such an illustrative scenarios, basically you need to collaborate. So it doesn't work in a way that we have a team and I'm alone sitting down and trying to write up the scenarios, write up the BDDs, as some people say that, because then it will be just reflecting my own view and maybe I find some joy when writing those scenarios, but definitely it will not inspire the other team members. And so it should be a collaborative effort. However, and I think this is what the practice was showing, that that writing up a proper scenario requires you to take care of many different things. Obviously, you need to figure out that what is the case, what is the scenario that you would like to describe there, what is the business flow that that is somehow exciting or important, and we would like to turn it into a scenario. But because the scenario has some sort of fixed format, you have to use the Gherkin keywords, you want to reuse some existing steps, you want to make sure that it's a proper grammar structure, proper English, whatever. So you also have to focus on this technical aspect of that. And especially if you are doing it together with other people, that technical aspect, so the technical writing aspect of that is basically slowing you down. Typically the situation is, and maybe some of the listeners have already experienced that you are sitting in a virtual room, let's say, or in a physical room together with five, six people, you get an idea that, okay, let's make a scenario for this. And then you are starting to write down, and maybe two people is starting to go into a discussion of some word ordering and whatever. Do we have a step already for that or not? All the others are basically just falling out of the discussion, and then the rhythm of the meeting is basically not working very well. So we know what we want. We want to have these inspirative scenarios that are driving us. That's the driven part of the behavior-driven development. But immediately writing that together as a collaborative session is hard. And to be able to fix this problem, basically the BDD practitioners have realized that that actually what we are doing has two aspects. The one is that what is that key scenario, key example to be able to finally introduce our term. What is the example that we would like to tell? What is this small little story that we would like to tell about the functionality? And the other thing is how to write it down properly into Gherkin with the given when then keyword. And to be able to have this creative part, so when trying to figure out what are those key scenarios that are important for us, actually writing down proper Gherkin is too much. And therefore, people just found some more lightweight way. At a time before the COVID, maybe we were even picking up some sticky notes and just writing up those examples in a very lightweight way, like, and user does that, and this is what we want to have as a result. And we call these things immediately nowadays examples. Basically, they are fitting to the example-based learning concept. So whenever you learn something, you are typically not learning it in a way that you just try to understand the complex rules, but you are just coming up with the examples, and through the examples, you will be able to learn that. So that's basically the concept of the examples, or how examples get into BDD. So basically, it's a lightweight form of a scenario, if you see it like that, to be able to exercise this creative part of the collaboration. So, and now your question was that why don't we want, so how do we decide that which examples become scenarios afterwards, or why isn't all, or how many examples do we need to create? And basically, maybe you started to already feel the answer, so that at the time where we are all together and just throwing in the examples, trying to figure out what is the essence of that requirement, what are those key examples that are really illustrating that nice, we don't really want to think about that, whether that example will really make sense as an automated test or not, whether that example has a little bit of overlap with the other or not, because we don't want to break out this creativity by that. So we are just basically fleshing out a bunch of examples, which we as a team think that they are covering the really exciting part of the requirements. And then once this is done, then we move on with our step. We will evaluate these examples, and probably majority of them will be turned into scenarios. But maybe there will be some which was useful to capture at that moment because that was helping us to move forward with the meeting. But at the end, it turns out that turning that into an automated test doesn't really give any value. Then why should we waste our time with that? So that's basically how this could be seen.
Excellent. That's a fantastic answer. With all the details that I wanted. Let's talk a bit about the automated tests. I really wanted to cover it later in the session, but as this came up in my mind, I just wanted to ask this. The automated tests are written through BDD and they could pass, but the system might have complex issues which lead to various other severe problems in production. What do we do about this? So certainly the automated tests written in BDD may not be sufficient for making sure that the system is good enough to be in the production. What do you think?
Definitely. So I think testing has been around for a couple of decades now, but still it's very interesting that many people who are just entering the world of testing doesn't have a real definition in their mind what a test is. And because the thing is very controversial. So just because you have green tests, doesn't matter which kind of test, it doesn't necessarily mean that your product is bug-free or quality, right? So based on that, it's very hard to find a definition of what a test is. And I really like the definition that I heard from Dan North in one of his presentations. He was basically saying that the test is basically an evidence that can improve your confidence about the quality of the system. Not exactly what he was saying with like that, but that's what was the core part of that. So basically, it's something that can improve your confidence or increase your confidence in the thing that you are doing. And I really like this definition because if you see the tests, see your own tests through this window, then you can look at every single test and say that, okay, I have this BDD test. Do I feel that if I see this BDD test passing, then am I more sure that the product is more quality? Yes, no. If yes, then this is probably a good test. What other things would be necessary to be able to increase my confidence? Maybe I have all my BDD scenarios green, but obviously the BDD scenarios are focusing on the end-to-end value and the happy paths, or at least the more common paths. Can I sleep well, and shouldn't I be afraid of some sort of edge case problems, security problems, whatever other things, integration problems, network latency issues? Probably not. And then if I think that I'm not confident enough on those areas, then I should find what is a better way for testing for that. And what drops out of that is that for checking out all the different edge cases, probably some sort of unit tests are better to check the security aspects. Maybe some security testing is useful, and a lot of other sorts of tests. And these are working very well together with BDD. BDD is focusing on the business requirements and even the core value of the business requirements, not so much on the details. And typically unit tests are very well combined with BDD, where you can more focus on still the functional part, but more on the low level details. And altogether, that mix provides you a better coverage, I would say.
Yes, and also the human testing that happens after the code is developed is also important. But these days, it's getting really difficult to get the human testing done because of the CI/CD pipeline. That's beside the point, but thanks for the input on that. So while doing the examples, we put aside the topics that cannot be answered right away, correct? To use the analogy, we have these red cards that you had mentioned. So when do we address these red cards, or when do we address these scenarios which cannot be answered? Because how far should these be postponed? Because the cost and the schedule will be affected because of undecided items, either be it an agile project or otherwise. We have a customer to answer and we have a schedule to follow. How soon should we address these undecided items?
So the concept of these red cards, or the question cards, was and probably you have also experienced that in your meetings as well. I have attended many times requirement related meetings where we started to discuss the things, but we very very easily got lost in some small little detail that we cannot answer. Yeah. And typically that ruins the entire meeting, because everyone is just coming back to that. Yes, but what about that A case that we couldn't solve? Whatever that and we cannot really progress. Basically, with the example mapping or that kind of process of BDD, we are making these things a little bit more explicit, so that obviously if something is unknown or something is we cannot answer. This is not something that a meeting facilitation can fix. But what it can be used for is to make these things explicit and visual and visible, so that just by saying out that we declare that this particular thing we cannot answer now is immediately helping the meeting to move forward, because then we are reducing the kind of loops and unnecessary excursions coming back and back to that problem. Obviously this is not an ideal situation. So the best would be if we would be able to solve everything, because as you see, so those questions, those undecided items can be even blocking for the implementation. But and obviously you need to address those and try to get those fixed as soon as possible. But the interesting thing is that how this process is long-term helping you with that. Because once you get into that rhythm And once the team knows that in this discussion, this is going to be the process how we are trying to discover the requirements. So they know that we will think about examples and we will think about rules and whatever other artifacts. Then they can already prepare better for that. So the product owners will already start thinking in examples when they are preparing the user stories, and therefore in long term, the chance or the frequency of having some unknown items or unanswered questions will be, it never will be, never be zero, but it will definitely drop, and in long term there will be less and less of such items. And the other thing that how teams work in this situation is that they are trying, and I know that many teams are anyway doing that, but they are trying to replace the big planning meetings with multiple smaller meetings. So many teams are just doing such an example mapping session, a small backlog refinement session twice a week. And then if there is any unanswered question on one meeting, that's still not a disaster, because in 2 days' time, there will be another one where we can fix that. And that can help you to get into the expected readiness state by the beginning of the sprint if you do Scrum.
Great. So I had this question because I just recently had a discussion about software requirements in a fixed cost, fixed schedule kind of environment where its requirements are getting affected because the schedule and the cost are getting affected and customers, they are furious about the project not completed. So anyway, so let's get into this different facets of software development, right? So we have these different facets like performance, security, we have UI, UX, we have fault management, we have accounting, we have functionality. If you ask me, I would like to have all these as BDD requirements because that makes my job very easy in nailing the requirements, in coming up with scenarios, and then addressing them in code. But there would be challenges in addressing all this with BDD. From your experience, how many of the projects have implemented performance or security related requirements as part of BDD?
I think your feeling comes from the fact that the concept what BDD is also using is this example-based specification. And as I said even in the beginning, example-based learning is something that is part of the human nature. So this is not something that BDD invented that generally helps understanding the things if you are coming up with examples. And because of that, generally the concept that BDD follows could be applied to any of those areas. And I think in some areas we even do that. So for example, if you think about UX, then having a UI sketch or a visualized user workflow, that's a concrete example which is showing how the system is going to look like in that particular case. So basically that's also using the same concept. Theoretically, you could even move forward and even turn those things also to BDD scenarios as well. Usually I don't recommend that though. And basically because of two, I think my main reason is that it just confuses people. So what people like is that if one test has one concrete purpose, if you know that BDD scenarios are for the high level business functional testing, then it will be easier to explain anyone in the team or if a new people joining to the team that what we are doing with those BDD scenarios, how should we phrase those scenarios, what kind of language we should use there. So it's easy to say, for example, that don't use technical language. However, if you would use the same technology also to verify, for example, the performance or the security, then it would be a little bit confusing because then you would need to say that if you are in this area, use the business language. If you are in that area, you can use security language as well. So it just, I think it would just confuse people. And I think right now the clarity and the good team spirit is a very important goal. So because of that, I have seen a few teams who were trying to do such things, especially with I've seen that with security. I've seen some people who are expressing their DevOps expectations of what kind of server has to be configured for that particular thing. All those things described in BDD, which absolutely makes sense in theory, but because of these practical reasons, I think not many teams are doing that. And I also would be careful with that.
Yeah, makes sense. As long as the business stakeholders understand the BDD scenarios and they are able to grasp the keywords that are being used on a particular technology, especially security is very complex in terms of these keywords. I can understand performance related things because I can say that, you know, I want to have 2000 users log into a website at the same time, which is a performance requirement, which can be directly expressed as a BDD scenario. But there are some areas which could really get technical, as you said, like keywords could be really complex, which may not be comfortable for the business owners. So yeah, that makes sense. So we need to have a balance. Let's talk about Three Amigos. So the Three Amigos is being taken literally as the number of people in many scenarios. You had mentioned that, you know, it's actually three hats or three functionalities that needs to be mentioned. So especially in software testing, we have areas where that might be experts addressing individual aspects. For example, the security threat modeling is addressed by a different expert than someone who is monitoring and observing security in the production. So they are two different people. They might need to attend the same BDD meeting and try to clarify things. So I think we need to really make it clear that the Three Amigos is not to denote a number, but to denote functions. But it is still happening. And many times when we say tester in a Three Amigos scenario, they think that it's the test architect or the test lead who would represent testing in a BDD meeting. But as you know, the test architect or the test lead may not be an expert in all aspects of software testing, like performance and security. And we need to have more people who can represent those areas. So I don't know, this is really a practical problem. That's you know, this misunderstanding. Probably we might need a different terminology or address this in a different fashion.
Yeah. It's very funny because sometimes there are some terms in IT for sure, but probably in other areas as well, where nobody was really coming up with this term that it will just ruin the world at the end. But I think this is a nice term. Everyone would like to have friends, so I don't know why. And therefore people were just picking up this Three Amigos thing. It really wasn't designed in a way that it will be a world famous quote. So it was just happened to that someone started to name their meetings like that. But what you were saying is absolutely right. I think the core concept of Three Amigos is that that we have to step forward from that classical view that basically the requirement primarily has to be understood by the developers only, and maybe even just a key developer who will just forward this knowledge to the other developers. And once this is done, then in a separate meeting, maybe the testers also get informed about what they are going to be testing, and that is. We would like to change that. We would like to turn this knowledge sharing, how do we get the requirements into a collaborative effort. And for that, it's very important that different perspectives are somewhat represented in that meeting. So, and what comes up primarily is that we might have different roles. So I'm maybe a developer, I'm a tester, I'm a product owner. There are already three roles that have to be represented. But if you are thinking about and even as you said, there are even multiple roles, because maybe there is someone is a UX expert or security expert, which doesn't fit into these categories. Of course, their perspective might be also very important. But even every individual who is working on that team will have their own perspectives, will have their own background, will their own understanding of the business problem so far. and they can contribute to that meeting. So basically what I usually suggest that if it is possible and if you can solve that, then try to get the entire team who will work with that user story together, and don't leave out anyone just because we already have a developer in the meeting, so we don't need a second one. Maybe that second developer will drop in that question that will lead to a very complex problem that otherwise we would only discover late. These meetings, these requirement meetings, are somehow also called that they are some sort of deliberate discovery, deliberate learning. So that we are coming together to learn about the requirements together. The more perspective, more people are there, the better picture we will build up from that, and the less problems will be caused by forwarding that information, forwarding that knowledge to someone else. So yes, Three Amigos is a very nice term. People like that. People immediately have some visualization, maybe even for that. But don't take that literally.
Absolutely. So in these days of ensemble programming and all that, where the different experts are being consulted while the coding is done, it's absolutely required that we also have the different experts in the requirement stage also. While most of the defects are found to be found in the requirement stage, it's pretty important that we need to have the experts and all the key inputs in the requirement stage itself so that we can reduce the defects as far as possible from a software testing and quality perspective.
Exactly. Maybe if it helps to someone, that basically what we are doing in that requirement meeting or this requirement discussion meeting, we are already finding the bugs that you haven't even coded into the system. So it's a kind of a bug prevention that we are doing there. Those issues that we haven't discussed there, probably at the end they will become bugs. So the more questions we can discuss in that meeting, the better it will be.
Yeah,
or the cheaper it will be at the end.
I was talking to a performance tester a couple of days back for a podcast, and I came to know that they are not even including testers in the requirements discussion. That was pretty concerning, because you know, we need to have performance testers also in the requirements discussion right from the start, so that they can give their valuable inputs.
Especially if the business is like that, where the performance is a very important business criteria. And nowadays many products and many businesses have this as an important factor, yes.
Absolutely. The example method that is quoted to be suited for agile and lean methods, right? Does that mean that BDD cannot be used for a large complex projects that are still agile and lean, but they are large and complex projects?
No, I don't think so. So there are many teams, even in larger projects, in larger enterprises, that are already using BDD. Basically, what it's more says that BDD will not solve the big enterprise problems. There are other tools for that, but basically BDD solves the problem when the problem has been broken up into smaller pieces, like a user story, and that user story is assigned to a particular team, and that team needs to solve that user story in the best possible way.
Excellent. Let's talk about the when class in the BDD scenario, right? I had a discussion in Twitter about multiple when classes in a rule. There could be situations where two or more events need to happen for an outcome to happen, right? And none of these events are pre-existing conditions which can be made as part of a given class. They have to be in when class. For example, you have two processes that are running, and probably the two processes are terminating at any point of time. Both of them are required for an action to be taken. In this case, I would say that the when is not a single event, but a couple of events happening. But many say that my when class has to have only one event for an action to be taken. So how do I combine two events which are independent and required for an action to be taken in a when class?
That's a very interesting question. And And the answer is that what is a single event or not a single event, that depends on the abstraction level that you see. So just to give you a real life example, when I say I enter my home, is this one event or multiple events? Yeah, you would say that this is one event. But if I break it down that I'm just putting the key into the keyhole, turn it around, open the door, step into that, you see that one event is built up multiple events. So the same thing happens with software development as well. So there are some things where we feel, or where the requirement is that that something should happen if multiple things are finishing, working together, do something with each other. So let's just take your example that let's say that two background jobs are running independently of each other. And if both of them has been finished, then we have to do something. But as I see it now, it becomes one event at the end, because I say that when both of them are finished, then something should happen. Of course, I could say to that when A finished, when B finished, but this would be really lying, because actually what is important on that they are both finished. And the same thing happens, and in the, from the automation perspective, the automation code will be exactly the same, but by emphasizing that there is a single thing that we would like to focus on in that particular scenario and turning it into a single event step, then is basically making the scenario better understandable, and it will help the reader to pay attention. So if you just say that if process A has finished, when process A has finished and process B has finished, then the reader might have the feeling that it was important that which order they were finishing, or that kind of it could even mislead the reader. However, if you say that if both are, when both are finished, then it just goes straight to the point and explains what it is. So basically this question of number of events is typically a question of the abstraction level, or how much you have really found the intention of that particular scenario, and how much you were able to take that piece out of the many small events that are happening during the execution of that one. What I usually suggest for that, and it's a stupid analogy, but I call it the coffee machine method. Just forget about that you are doing BDD. Just imagine that you are standing at the coffee machine and a colleague of you is just coming by and you would like to explain them what you are currently working on. And try to listen to yourself. What would you say? So probably you would not say that, hey, I'm working on the thing where process A has finished and process B has finished. But you would say that, hey, I'm working on the thing but when both of those has finished, then this and this should happen. So normally people are, when you are using your normal verbal communication, typically you are finding the right abstraction level to explain the things. But whenever we just get into the desk where we would need to write give and then dance, we are somehow becoming too technical and feeling that we are too much bound to those steps, existing steps, whatever else. And it's easy to get off the ground with this. So that's the basically the answer. We had a discussion with Seb because when we were writing the book, we were thinking about how hard we should phrase that, whether we should say that every scenario should have maximum one van step, or you should say that every scenario, usually the scenarios have only one van step. And when we were having this discussion, we were making it, turning it into a challenge that let's try to find a scenario with two van step where we feel happy with, and we couldn't find any. So I have found one in my code, but actually it turned out that was just pure laziness, and I haven't found the right abstraction. So so that wasn't really a good example at the end.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you so much for your input on that. Really appreciate that. When we try to address all possible combinations in examples, then we are moving into the software testing realm, right? Which is not the objective of example workshops, because the business owner might not be interested in all the possible combinations. This is agreed. But where should we plan for all the possible combinations? If it is not in BDD, then should this be done as part of TDD following the BDD?
Mm-hmm. So I think this question can be answered from two different aspects. One is that how should we handle this in time, so that in the timeline of the process and in terms of test methods. let me just start with the first one from the timing perspective. So as you said, typically on those meetings, we are not interested in all the different combinations, all the edge cases, but those are important things that we would like to test. In many teams are doing it in a way that based on those discussions, the team got enough input to do their job, in a sense that the developers got enough input to start working on the implementation of their applications, and the testers also got enough input to be able to start working on the calculation of the number of test cases, number of test case variations that would be required to reach the expected coverage, because that's sometimes a hard work. So even if you are realizing that this is a combinatoric problem, really choosing the right combinations, because you typically cannot test all of them, choosing the right combinations that are providing you a good coverage, that's a testing technique, and that's something that you have to sit down and spend some time with. That yes. An entire team will not help you with that. Maybe having a pair with you might, but not the entire team. So basically the process is that on that meeting, focus on the key examples. Developers start working on the code, testers start working on figuring out what kind of other test cases they should be done, and hopefully by the time then where the developers are finished, also the test cases are also designed, and that basically those additional test cases can be used as a kind of additional verification of the code. So that's the timing perspective. The tooling perspective, which you also mentioned, is also a very interesting one. And I think there is no very clear answer for that. So if the case is that that with the BDD scenarios, these illustrative few examples, let's say that we were coming up with two scenarios, okay, and during the test design we realized that there are three more needed, so three more, not much more, then probably also creating scenarios, maybe more additional scenario outline examples for that might be okay, especially if the BDD tests are running fast. So because it will not blow up the things. Even in that case, usually I like to mark those examples that these are not the illustrative ones, these are not the ones that were required for understanding the problem, these are just additional test cases. But you can use the same tooling, you can use Gherkin, you can use the same automation framework that you have built up for your scenarios. However, and I think in many cases this is the case, if those variation tests or combinatory tests are really blowing up, you need to have 20 other cases that you would like to test, then doing that through BDD is typically not that efficient, because BDD scenarios are more end-to-end, and they're
right,
because of that they will be more slow. Doing that those kind of tests in a low level unit test framework is probably much better and providing you a altogether better mix of tests that are also more fitting to the concept of the test pyramid as well.
So it almost looks like BDD will be a scaffolding on top of TDD, and BDD is the overall high level perspective, and then we then drill down to the TDD level to implement those possible combinations, sitting along with the testers, do a pair programming session or something like that, and nail down all those possible combinations.
Yes, that's definitely a usual strategy. But I don't want to say any definite answer, because I have seen that I think one of the problem of testing in our industry is that we are trying to put everything into the same schema and try the same happened with the test automation pyramid, that we somehow were hoping that that if it gets a shape of a pyramid, that will be giving us the answer of how to solve the testing. But that's not the case. Unfortunately, there is no fixed recipe that works everywhere. And I would like to encourage everyone to think about their own test strategy or test automation strategy, and see based on the needs of that concrete project and based on the context of that concrete project, what kind of combination works better for them. But I think that kind of pattern that BDD is covering the high level, TDD is covering the lower level details, it's a very common one. And I think definitely it's a good starting point for thinking.
That's a very wise advice. Thank you so much. Talking about the personalities of people taking part in BDD conversations, someone recently shared that they are an introvert, right? And they are not comfortable talking in the meetings. Is there a way to work around this, you know, for people who are not comfortable with discussions, meetings, and conversations? They are not easy for everyone, right? So how do we address this problem?
Yeah. When I started to have my first agile projects and agility was coming in, then I thought that, okay, from now on, everyone will be super talkative, super active in meetings, and we are all working as a great team together. But I have very quickly had to realize that this is not happening. So we have different personalities. Introvert, extrovert is even just one categorization, but there are plenty of other ways how we are different from each other. And it would be very stupid to say that, hey, if you are not talkative, not active in meeting, and not extrovert, then probably your opinion doesn't matter. That would be really stupid to say. So, and if you start from that, then basically the thing turns around. So instead of hoping that everyone will be super, let's say talkative in a meeting, let's try to think about it. How can we help those people to contribute who are not like that? And there will be no one single answer, but you need to find techniques that are allowing you to contribute in multiple different ways. And for example, with the example mapping that we were talking about, we are writing up cards. The cards are visual. They are arranged in a surface. They are written. So if somebody is better in writing, then they can contribute with writing. If somebody is better understanding the things by listening, we are anyway talking, so they can listen to that, or they can look at the cards and can read the text on that. Also, language barriers are much easier to handle that with that. And it provides you multiple ways of getting the information and multiple ways of providing the information. And trying that and try to practice that, basically that's a good way of really hearing about everyone's opinion and also helping them to get the necessary learning that is required for implementing the application in an efficient way. So basically the note for myself was that I shouldn't make any assumptions how people behave, because we are all behaving differently, but provide options that they can choose and they can find their own way to comfortably participating on that meetings.
Wonderful. So when a scenario is written or modified, it is required that the product owner, business owner, and the stakeholders review them. But that does not happen in reality many times. The scenarios are usually written and modified by a developer who is in a hurry, and a tester has no say to comment, give feedback, or raise an issue with the management because of this. Although the process outlined by BDD is fantastic, the reality is just that the scenarios are used to automate them into tests and not used for business conversations. Also, the business owners and product owners are very busy, and they delegate the review task to the developers. And I don't think it's a healthy thing to do in the BDD sprint. And this fails the whole purpose of BDD. How do you think we can address this problem?
Mm-hmm. So I think, at least based on my experience, but I have seen that if the business is part of creating these scenarios, then they are more feeling responsibility for those. So just to give you the two contrasts. So if the scenarios were written by the developers and the testers, and were automated by the developers and the testers, and modified by the developer and the testers, then obviously it will be very hard to involve the business, because they will just see that as a task that they have to get rid of this review task, and they are just trying to delegate it because that's what they have learned, that if you that delegation is a good thing. However, if they were part of the creation process, if they have been attending on those example mapping meetings, and the scenarios really have connection to those examples that they have discussed together, then they will very well remember that there was a big discussion on that example, and we were unsure whether it should be A or B in that case. And then finally we created a scenario for that, but definitely that business will better feeling responsible of what whether finally the chosen solution will be the one that that we finalized, or there it turns out that we have to change that later on. So that's one aspect that in my experience helps a lot. So giving something to review that you haven't had any affiliation with is hard, but giving something to your review that you have also created, or you were part of the creation of that, that's much easier to solve. The other thing that I have seen working is that we have to teach the businesses also that what kind of value is provided by them to review those scenarios, and what kind of value is also good for them based on that. So basically, if you just compare what happens if there is a change request, business is asking, writing an email that button should be green. You are replying that, okay, but why that button is green? Is this the right button that you were thinking about? And there is an email conversation back and forward. If you would count how many working hours we have spent on that to be able to finalize what the business really wanted, then you can compare that with a case where there is already a scenario, and I have seen that working many times, that and the business expresses their change request in a way that they are at least drafting out that, hey, what I want is almost this scenario, but here, instead of this dance step, actually I want to have something different. It's much easier to get to the point, and we have much less waste in the communication process to hand over those change requests. So that's we have to teach them, and we have to help them to see the value of taking care of this process, because there is a value at the end. Maybe this is not immediately visible when the message pops up for them that please review this scenario, but in long term this is definitely helpful. For reviews, the business doesn't necessarily have to review all the scenarios alone. So you can also try to just set up a meeting, a pair meeting with them, and instead of letting them read the scenarios, you can read them up or present those scenarios and have a discussion based on that. What kind of feedback they would do. You have to try different approaches and see which one works better, and that's the way basically to get them better involved in the process. And obviously there will be some changes always that are not related to the requirements. So you might need to change the scenarios because of some automation reasons where the meaning of the scenario didn't change, but actually because some automation details, you had to make some smaller changes. Those changes, if they are not get reviewed by the business, that's not so critical. I think that's our responsibility to really know whether this change has a business impact or this change doesn't have a business impact, and we should only start the review process if the change is affecting the requirements and you would like to get a confirmation from the business.
Absolutely. As you rightly said, it's about making the business owners see the business value in these kind of meetings, and then that will get their buy-in and time to make them participate in these kind of meetings. That's a very valuable input. Thank you so much for that. I think that's all I have from my side on the examples portion. These are some of the questions in many people's minds. So it has been very helpful that you answered these questions. I really look forward to talk to you on the formulation part of the examples in detail in another session. But in the meantime, what are your plans for the example portion?
I don't really have plans. I think whatever happened so far were never really planned, but it was just coming out of practice. And I really like that I have some coaching agreement with a couple of companies, and sometimes I'm just dropping in to do an example mapping together with them, or I have them facilitate these example mapping sessions. And those are always very good events, because it's one hand to see how the team is addressing some problems, and also a little bit helping them to really get the core part of that. But it's also good learning for me, because I also see what kind of patterns, what kind of behavior can be observed there, and what kind of things worked as a facilitation techniques, what kind of things didn't. So, and basically all those ideas and all those things that we had in the book were coming from these kind of concrete discussions. Of course, the world is working on that, and there are tools, or there are concepts of tools that will support example mapping from the tooling perspective. So especially now, as we are online, there are new ways of technically supporting these meetings with tooling, but I'm not directly part of those initiatives. I'm also just watching them, and I hope that there will be more and more tool support coming up for supporting this part of the BDD process.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for your inputs today, and I look forward to talk to you again on software testing and quality talks in my YouTube channel. It has been very helpful. We learned a lot from this discussion. Thank you so much, Gaspar.
Thank you very much for the interview, and I hope to see you, talk to you again.
Bye for now.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
It was a pleasure having Gaspar Nagy in our show. What are your thoughts on what we talked about? Please leave your comments in the video so that Gaspar or myself can comment on them. Also, don't forget to subscribe to this channel and click the bell icon to get notified when new videos are released in this channel. Thank you very much for listening to this podcast, and I look forward to see you again soon. Ta-da!